Next, I will be introducing to you Georgios Boudalis. He studied fine arts and art conservation in Florence, Athens, London, and Thessaloniki, where he has been head of book and paper conservation at the Museum of Byzantine Culture since 2000. He completed his PhD in 2005 on the evolution of Byzantine and post-Byzantine bookbinding, and has since published on issues of bookbinding history and manuscript conservation. His main interests are the evolution of bookbinding structures and the techniques in the Eastern Mediterranean, and how these can be studied using a combination of physical, written, and iconographical evidence. Since 2006, he has been teaching courses on the history of Eastern Mediterranean bookbindings, both on a historical and practical basis. He has been a visiting scholar and an adjunct professor at Bard Graduate Center in New York, where in 2018 he curated the exhibition, The Codex and Crafts in Late Antiquity, and published a book with the same title. He contributed to the JBC volume with a piece on straps, tabs, and strings, bookmarks in the codices of the St. Catherine's Monastery in Sinai. Georgios?
Thank you, Rhea. Can you see my screen, I hope? Yes.
Okay, yes.
Good. Okay, thank you. Thank you, everybody who's attending. What I'm presenting here is a research which started with bindings we surveyed in the Sinai collection, in the well-known project of the survey of the collection of the Sinai monastery library. And again and again, throughout the collection, we were coming across these broken straps here at the foredge of different books, both Greek books, Syriac, Georgian, and Arabic. So in all books of the four main linguistic groups of the collection, we would come across quite often, I think, I would say, these broken straps, which at the time we would call lifting tabs. I think we called them lifting tabs throughout the survey, because previously to that survey, these lifting tabs or these broken straps were only known from the Coptic collections, and mostly the Coptic collection, the Coptic Codices collection of the Morgan Library. And this is just an example of that. So it's not very, easy to spot or to notice if you don't know what you're looking at. But then in a board like that, these are the fastening straps. They're normally triple or double. And then in the middle of the foredge of one board or both boards, you occasionally come across this. Now, I think it was Peterson who surveyed this collection who first called these lifting tabs, because he suggested and he thought that this might have been used as straps or tabs for lifting the boards. That was his idea, based on the fact that all the examples he was aware of were all broken off. Okay, so there was nothing, no complete example known to that author and to people before the survey of the St. Catherine's Monastery, really. So back, I think, in 2003 or 2002, maybe, working with Jim Bloxham from the Cambridge University Library on a book, which I'm trying to remember which book was that. And I think that it must have been this one, Syriac 85. We came across this example and we were both very excited because at last we had a full example of a lifting tab. And so then this research started on bookmarks. So that was the starting point for this wider, I think, wider research on bookmarks, at least in the collection of the St. Catherine Monastery, which is a very obviously representative collection for Eastern Mediterranean bookbinding structures. So a bit of taxonomy or classification before we go, go on. So bookmarks, I think, can be divided, or at least bookmarks of the Eastern Mediterranean bindings can be divided in movable, fixed, and free. Movable, obviously, are the, or rather, movable, I call the bookmarks, which are fixed to a part of the book, but can be, their position within the book block can change. Fixed, those which are permanently fixed on a specific folio or leaf of a book, of a book block, and then free, any kind of material that can be inserted between leaves and act as a bookmark. And then further on, movable bookmarks can be divided in board strap markers and in endband string markers. We will see them in detail, so don't panic for those who are not familiar with the terms. And further on, endband string markers can be divided in simple and compound, and we will see them in a couple of minutes. Fixed bookmarks, on the other hand, can be divided in leaf string markers and leaf tab markers, okay? And then free, I haven't been able to, well, I found very few free bookmarks in the collection of the monastery, and therefore, to the point, there is no way to classify anything, really. Just two words about terminology here. So I'm using three words, really, to classify, to describe all this, or to name all these different bookmarks. The first word, this word describes the part of the book where the bookmark is attached, so it can be a board or an endband or a leaf. The second part describes the form of the marker itself, so it can be a strap, a string, or a tab, as actually the title of my contribution says. And then, of course, the third word is the word marker. Now let's quickly see each of them. Board strap markers, you got the idea. I think we all understand what they are and how they worked, how they acted. We came across quite a few complete examples in the Sinai collection. And as long as I can tell, there are, to my knowledge, there are no other complete examples preserved in other collections besides the Sinai collection, at least so far. Now, just notice here the stain left on the end leaf from the leather, the turnings, and the strap of the board marker, and we will come back to that in a few seconds. This is the complete, I think, graphic list of all the complete examples we found in the collection in the Sinai. But what was quite interesting and exciting at the same time was that even in many examples where the bookmarks themselves were gone, we could actually find an imprint or a stain of the original board strap markers, which subsequently were lost. This is an example which is from the collection of the Vlatador Monastery in Thessaloniki. I'm not sure how clearly it shows in the screen, but it is very clear on the actual book. So you don't get the strap, the board strap marker anymore, but you get a very clear impression of it. It's so clear that sometimes you even get the grain of the leather. And therefore, this is the list. It's not a complete list, but these are all examples recorded in the Sinai library of bookmarks, of board strap markers, which were have been identified because of their imprints on the books, on the leaves. Then the second type of movable bookmarks are the endband string markers. As the word says, these are strings that are attached on the endbands, normally, obviously, the headband of a book block, in different ways. And as I said, they can be divided in simple and in compound. So simple bookmarks, endband string markers, can be attached to the headband in different ways. And these drawings here show six of those I was able to identify. There will be probably more. And what we are seeing in these drawings are the back side of the endbands. So basically a thread or a string or a thin cord which was laced normally under the endband and somehow was fixed on the back side of it. And therefore in all these cases, more or less, I think we can safely conclude that these bookmarks were attached to the headband before covering, so they can be relatively dated with the rest of the binding. And then we have the compound bookmarks, headband string markers, which consist of two parts. One part is a loop, one or more loops, which are made in different ways. And these are attached in one way or another to the end, to the headband. And then subsequently on these loops, a cord or a thread or more cords or more threads can be attached. There can be different types of these. They can be very plain or rather elaborate. And this is an example of that. It is a cord, it is a string made with a technique called braiding, which in itself is a very interesting technique. And there are quite a few examples of this. And sometimes they quite nicely fit. I mean, you can feel there is someone some attention in selecting colors as to somehow match with either the decoration of the manuscript or often with the endband. Now for the fixed markers, let's see the leaf string markers. These are just cords or threads which are laced through the leaves of a book block or sewn on the edges of the leaves of a book block, obviously extending from the foreheads. And these are two examples from the Sinai collection. This is an example, it's a broken one, but this is from the Codex Sinaiticus, the bulk of the Codex Sinaiticus, which is now in the British Library. And this photograph, in fact, is from the British Library. And then leaf tab markers, I'm sure this is much more, what I wanted to say is that leaf string markers are not specific to bindings or book blocks recorded in the Sinai. These are rather common in Armenian bindings, Islamic bindings as well. So a bit more common than the previous ones. Leaf tab markers, as I said, I'm sure you will be much more familiar with these. Pieces of leather or textile, which are pasted on the foreheads of the leaves or specific leaves, the leaves that someone would like to mark permanently, usually the opening of chapters or things like that. And they can be, as I said, leather, made out of leather cuttings or textile cuttings, this is the image that one would see at the forage of the book. Unlike similar markers used in Western books in which I think in all cases, the tabs would extend beyond the foreheads of the book block. In the eastern part of the Mediterranean, in all those bindings, all these tab markers are always cut flush with the book block. And there are some interesting examples as well, in which case wax is used to mark the leaves. So wax, pieces of wax, which have been kneaded probably is to make them soft and then pressed onto the edges of the leaves as to permanently stick on the leaves that the reader would want to mark. A few more words. Being able to work on the survey of on the material collected through the survey of the whole collection of the Sinai gave me the real privilege to be able to use data collected throughout the collection. So I was able to use the data from about 3,500 manuscripts of the library, and therefore it was possible to work some basic statistics as to the rise and the gradual decline of bookmarks, of specific type of bookmarks as opposed to others. So that made also, I think an interesting part of the research. For example, do notice that by the 14th century, 13th, 14th century, for specific linguistic groups, bookmarks can be found in 100% of the books. So there is no book without a bookmark, and consider also that there are books which combine all these different bookmarks together. maybe excluding the endband string markers, which seem to be a later thing. And last, I would close with two words on the iconographical evidence. When we first made this suggestion that these straps were used as bookmarks, I immediately thought that you need more than that to prove or to support that suggestion. And I immediately thought that the place to look for evidence would be the iconographical evidence. And so I went through Byzantine art, mostly miniatures, but also icon painting, wall paintings, etc. And indeed, I found quite a few evidence of that. The only type of bookmark of those I've discussed before, that of which I couldn't find any iconographical evidence, are the endband string markers, which is in a way interesting because they seem to be very common from the 15th century onward. Anyway, and I have presented, for some of you, it might be already, you might be already aware of this iconographical evidence, because this was one of the main examples I discussed in a paper presented in the Care and Conservation of Manuscripts Conference in Copenhagen a few years ago. Last thing I want to say, to acknowledge the help of several people. Definitely this work, this research wouldn't be able to complete or to start even without the privilege to be part of the Sinai survey team. Definitely Nicholas Pickwood is to thank, Michael Gallick also, who has worked on this paper, especially in the beginning of it, in the early stages of it. And then different colleagues, Maria Argiru has helped me a lot with taking photographs in one of her visits in the monastery of different examples. Last is, I want to say that this has been one of the quite intriguing researches I did through, especially in the early years of my involvement with research in bookbinding. And I'm sure that some people will be still laughing of remembering me being completely excited when we would come across a new example of a board strap marker. And also the fathers in the monastery, I'm sure they will still probably remember all those excitement in all of us, really, not just me, when we would come across one of those mysterious at the beginning board stamp markers, but I think very well familiar now. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Georgios.